So you know that what is GST? It is an indirect system of taxation which subsumes all the central and state's indirect taxes. Okay. Secondly, you have this information that it is a consumption-based, destination-based tax, and it is premised on the value addition. Okay. So in each and every stage, whatever value you add, the tax will be levied on that particular value. Okay. So it is similar to VAT, but we know that VAT in the case was with respect to state government, and for central government we had this central excise. All right. So one of the thing which we often hear is GST will help in removal of cascading effect. Okay. But now we are also telling that GST is based on VAT system. Okay. So what is the difference? How GST is helping in removing the cascading system? Okay. So you see, earlier what used to happen was there was a center and there was a state. Okay. This state government was levying its value addition tax, okay, on the product value of the goods which were produced. All right. So here we had VAT. Okay. But in case of central government, we had excise duty. Okay. Now, when this excise duty of, let's say, 10%, it's just for our understanding, let's say 10% excise duty is levied on what? Any particular item. Okay. And let's say production cost is 100 rupees. All right. So when this item, after addition of central excise, would go into the state government and further value addition will take place in the state, what will happen? This value of VAT would have been levied on this 110 rupees. Okay. And at various stages, whatever stages 1, 2, 3, 4, okay, whatever stage this item will pass through, the value addition tax would have been applied on 110 rupees. Okay. So the 10 rupees of excise was taken into the cascading effect. Cascade. Okay, all right. But now what we are doing is we are removing this excise duty, and whatever, whenever a particular item is consumed at a particular location, we are levying GST. Okay. If the movement of the goods is within the state itself, we'll levy CGST as well as SGST. Okay. The in most of the cases these two are equal. Okay. Until now it is equal. So CGST will go to the center, SGST will go to the state. Okay. In those cases where the movement of goods take place from one state to another, what we levy is IGST, and the value of this IGST is sum total of CGST and SGST, and it is equally divided by among the center and the states. Alright. So because of GST, the cascading effect of the tax on excise duty was removed. Alright. So this is something with respect to some basic concept of GST. Now, in last year, some of the issues have arrived with respect to GST. The first issue was of e-way bill, and the second issue was your national anti-profiteering authority. All right. And then there were certain reduction in rates. Okay, many of the items which earlier had 28% of rate were brought down from that slab to 18% slab. Alright, so these are the various issues which we can talk about with respect to GST, and on these issues question can be asked this year. Okay, so you mainly have to focus on these issues, okay, and not on how GST is leading to cooperative federalism and how it is consumption based value addition tax. Those kind of question will not be asked. Okay, so e-way bill is nothing that, it is only telling that whenever a transporter is carrying on the products from one place to another, it has to generate an e-way bill system. Okay, it has to generate an e-way bill, and that e-way bill will help the authorities to see whether this consignment is correct or not. All right. So e-way bill is leading to your transparency, and it is also leading to increased revenue. All right. So you just have to remember e-way bill in context of transportation of goods or not services, but only goods. Okay. Now, as far as this National Anti-Profiteering Authority is concerned, you have to understand the difference between the term profit and profiteering. Okay. So, having or getting profit is not a illegal activity, but profiteering in general is illegal. Okay. So, the difference between profit and profiteering is something which you need to understand. Alright. So, profit is what? The surplus which you get over the cost price. Okay. And profiteering is something which you are extracting from the consumer through illegal means. Alright. Now, earlier when you used to go to buy a burger, okay, the cost of this burger was, let's say, 100 rupees and the taxation was, let's say, 18%. So, the total cost would have come to 118 rupees. Alright. Now, the government has reduced this 18% to, let's say, 5%. Okay. So, 18% has now been reduced to 5%. Alright. But when you go to the same restaurant to buy that same burger, you will still have to pay rupees 118. Okay. But in reality, what you have to pay was rupees 100, which was the cost earlier, plus rupees 5, which was the new tax. So you had to pay 105 rupees, but still you are paying 118 rupees. So rupees 13 is something which you are paying as something to the shopkeeper or to the producer. Okay, and this is something which we call as profiteering. So the shopkeeper is doing what? They are increasing the rate of this 100 rupee to, let's say, 110 or 12 rupees. Okay, and if you calculate 5% on this 112 rupees, it will certainly come up to 118 rupees. Okay, so the shopkeeper, without raising its cost of production, is just trying to increase the price, as a result of which you are at a loss. The benefit of GST is not passed on to the consumers. And this is what we call as anti-profiteering. Okay. So what the government has done, or it was found that in many countries where this system of GST was introduced, okay, there was inflation. Okay, for example, in Australia, in Singapore, you've found that after the introduction of GST, the prices of various commodities shot up. Okay, there was inflation. Why? Because the traders were involved in doing some kind of illegal activity to raise the price, despite there was low tax. Alright. So, to tackle this kind of situation, when Malaysia introduced GST, they had this authority which was tasked with identifying the people who were involved in generating profit through illegal means. Okay, so as a result of that, Malaysia was able to check the increase of prices of different commodities, and there was no issue of raised inflation. And that is the reason India also has constituted this National Anti-Profiteering Authority, which is mandated to identify the people who are involved in such kind of activities, so that inflation can be checked, so that the benefits of reduced tax is passed on to the consumers. Alright. So, as far as the composition and the various mandate of this NAPA is considered, it is important for prelims perspective, not for mains. Okay, you just need to have this analytical understanding of what is the work of National Anti-Profiteering Authority. Somewhere it is also mentioned at NAA. Okay, you can use whatever short form you like to use. Alright. So, and this government has also come up with the anti-profiteering rules 2017. Okay, so you can write in your notes about e-way bill and anti-profiteering rules. So in one line you can write, e-way bill is an electronic way. E-way bill is an electronic way bill for movement of goods which can be generated which can be generated on the GST network. Okay, next line, a movement of goods of more than 50,000. A movement of goods of more than rupees 50,000 in value cannot be made by a registered person without an e-way bill. It means that whenever you are transporting or moving goods worth more than rupees 50,000, you need to generate a e-way bill. Alright, next line, it is based on the radio frequency. It is based on the radio frequency identification technology. It is based on the radio frequency identification technology. Now, since this technology is in practice in the Indian context, this technology can be asked in your science and technology question as well. That what is RFID, how does it work, and how it is different from the Bluetooth technology or some other kind of technology. Alright. Now, write about anti-profiteering rules. These rules prevent entities. These rules prevent entities from making excessive profits. Okay. Many countries that adopted GST witnessed a rise in inflation after implementation. Malaysia was able to avoid a similar situation. Malaysia was able to avoid a similar situation by effectively implementing the anti-profiteering rules. Okay. So next line you can add, the anti-profiteering rules 2017. The anti-profiteering rules 2017 lays down details about the first point, selection of the members of the NAA. Selection of the members of the NAA and other committees. Second point, procedure to be followed in investigations. Procedures to be followed in investigations. Third point, powers given to the authority. Okay, so the question, if question is on NAPA or NAA, you need to discuss about the functioning of this objective of constituting this authority, and then you mention about this anti-profiteering rules and what are its mandate. All right now you do you need to understand the criticism of GST, that what are the various criticism of GST? लिखना चाहोगे आप लोग, ये आप लोगों को पता है. Okay, so in short you can write criticism of GST, because every one of you will be knowing the advantages of GST. Okay, one nation one tax, take consumption rate, cascading effect is reduced. So write down criticism of GST. The first criticism is, it is not a simple tax but a complex one. It is a complex tax having four tax slabs. Having four tax slabs. So we say that GST is a one nation, one tax, but this tax is not a one tax, but it has four different tax rates. Okay, 0% is not counted in that rate, 5%, 12%, 18%, and 28%. All right. Now next line you can write, about 19% of services, about 19% of the services have been under the highest slab. About 19% of the services have been under the highest slab of 28%, which caters to the daily needs of the middle class. So approximately 1/5 of the total requirements of the middle class is put in the highest tax bracket. Okay, next line is, next point, GST should have been under one unified tax authority. Okay, continue here, that there will be a diarchy. There will be a diarchy states and the center will divide the tax basis. State and the center will divide the tax basis into 90:10 ratio for turnover less than 15 million rupees okay, and 50-50 for turnover over 15 million rupees. Okay, so we talk of GST as a something which is an example of cooperative federalism. Okay, but if you go to the CBDT, which has now been designated as CBIT, you will find that many of the officers are not happy with the present regime of GST because many of their powers are now being shared by the state government authorities. Okay, so who is going to collect from whom? These are the implementational problems which may be faced with this GST regime. Alright, next point you can write, there is ambiguity about the anti-profiteering rules. There is ambiguity about the anti-profiteering rules as they do not lay down. There is ambiguity about the anti-profiteering rules as they do not lay down the formula based on which the extent of profiteering can be determined. As they do not lay down the formula based on which the anti-profiteering, based on which the extent of anti-profiteering can be determined. Alright, now you have created this body, NAA, and you have told this body that your objective is to go and look out for the people or entities who are creating profiteering, okay, who are having profit because by cheating the people. Okay, now how is this body going to determine whether a particular entity is involved in profiteering or not? Okay, this is left to the discretion of this body. So there is no objective criteria by which this body can identify who is committing this crime or not. Okay, so this will create some kind of inspector, as okay, the members of this body can go to some entity and say that give me some money or else I'll file a case against you under the anti-profiteering rules. Alright, so this should not have been the case, and hence it is expected or it is required that some objective criteria should be given in the rules itself, that considering the past performances, let's say, or considering the market conditions, okay, we need to identify who is creating excess profit or not. Alright, last point is, GST should have been given GST should have been given a trial run of 2 months before it was finally rolled out. Before it was finally rolled out, because you see, this is one of the criticism, because when the GST was first launched, many problems emerged, like the GST network was crashed. Okay, we have to postpone it to some different date. Okay, so these are some of the issues which you face with respect to GST. Now, one statement is important with respect to GST, and a question might be asked in GS3. Write down, the new tax regime is not perfect. The new tax regime is not perfect. The new tax regime is not perfect, but both its positives and negatives, are being exaggerated. Now, this statement was given by the Niti Aayog member Vivek Debroy, and he said that this tax regime is not perfect. Okay, it has certain issues, like we just discussed, that it is complex, having 4 tax labs. Okay, the various authorities who are dealing with this tax is not knowing what kind of work they have. Alright, so there are some imperfections associated with GST, but still you have the people have exaggerated their negatives and positives. For example, we are saying it is a complex tax. Okay, but still it is better than what we used to have earlier. Earlier we used to have 19 central and state level indirect taxes. So now we have brought down it to 4. So it is better. Okay, it is not something which is very complex. Alright. So a question can be asked by giving this statement and asking you to discuss this statement or to evaluate it critically. Okay, so in that case you have to write about the various positives, various negatives, and conclude on positive lines. Alright. यही सब चीजें तो क्लियर नहीं है ना. दीज आर द इश्यूज. आई मीन यू हैव सेड दैट 90% ऑफ द रेवेन्यूज विल गो टू द स्टेट गवर्नमेंट, बट हु विल कलेक्ट दिस 90% इज नॉट क्लियर राइट नाउ. ओके, अभी तो क्या है कि लोग जो है, जो वॉट एवर, लेट्स से बिजनेसमैन हैज एनुअल टर्नओवर ऑफ मोर देन लेस देन 15 मिलियन रुपी. ओके, सो वॉट एवर मनी ही विल बी कलेक्टेड एज टैक्स, 90% विल गो टू द स्टेट्स एंड 10% विल गो टू द सेंटर. But who will collect this 90%? Who will collect this 10%? These are the rules, the implementation drawbacks, which are still not clear in the public domain. ठीक है? कौन क्या करेगा, कैसे करेगा? These are not clear. Okay. But then you also know that you have the CGST and IGST. CGST, SGST, IGST. Now, in case of IGST, it is clear that the central government will levy and collect it and share it with the states. Okay. But this CGST and SGST, okay, who will collect the CGST, who will collect the SGST? Okay, so these are various problems which are associated with GST. Okay. With time, over the time, the CBIT and the state level tax authorities will decide that, okay, my officials will go and collect this tax, your official will go and collect that tax. Okay, so these are the issues. These are not very clear right now. Okay. So this is why we have mentioned it in the negative section. ये 90-10 का रेशियो है ना. आई मीन अगर आपका टर्नओवर 15,000 के पास है, कम है, लेसे इट इज 14 मिलियन रुपीज. ओके, so 90% of the tax which is levied on this 14 million rupee will be collected by the states. Okay. And 10% will be collected by the center. Now, you have said that out of, let's say, the tax comes out to be rupees 100. You are saying that 90 rupees will be collected by the state. So how you are going to collect this 90 rupee? Okay. Matlab aap kaise karoge? You are going to send your authority, tax authority, to that area. Okay. And whether and how the center government is going to collect rupees 10. Okay, so these are the issues which are still in the process. We need to overcome these challenges of GST. Okay. Kagaj pe to likh diya gaya ki yes, it is 90 is to 10, 50 is to 50. Okay, but in actual practice, in the field level, how we are going to collect that? It is an issue. Alright. So you write changes in GST. There were certain changes that were made by the government. Kuch elections aane wale the. So central government decided to change something. So the first change was reduction in GST rate. Write down, the council recommended reducing the number of items under the 28% tax slab from 224 to 50. From 224 to 50. Second point is eligibility under the composition scheme. Eligibility under the composition scheme. Now, composition scheme is nothing, it is very simple to understand. Let's say you have a small business. Okay. You have a small business entity. Okay. Now, for this small business to consistently on a daily basis create various tax invoices, okay, and inform the GST network, it needs to employ one another person to tackle the issue of tax, to maintain the tax records. Okay, so inka kharcha bad jayega. Okay, so to avoid additional burden of filing GST on a daily basis or on a weekly basis or on whatsoever basis, okay, the government decided to create some kind of composition scheme. So under the composition scheme, the small entities are required to pay a flat rate of tax on the overall turnover. For example, if their turnover is 1 crore, okay, so they need to pay a certain amount of X percent of 1 crore. If their turnover is 50,000, so they'd only have to pay X percent of 50,000 and like that. Okay, so they did not file GST on the GST network, not GST network, they did not file GST on a day-to-day basis. Okay, so this is something which we are simplifying the filing of tax from the small entities. Alright. So this is only the composition scheme. You need not go much deeper into that. You just remember that composition scheme is with respect to simplification of filing of tax, indirect tax, by the small entities. Alright. So, yeah, I'll make you write that. So you can write under this. Right? The central and state GST laws, the central and state GST laws allow certain taxpayers with annual turnover less than 1 crore rupees to pay GST on turnover instead of the value of supply of goods and services, instead of the value of supply of goods and services. Full stop. The council recommended increasing this limit. The council recommended increasing this limit to 2 crore rupees. This change will be implemented after the central and state GST laws. After the central and state GST laws are amended. Tax on agriculture. Now, this is an important topic for your this year means tax on agriculture. Under this you write, a committee set up in 1925 to assess the feasibility of taxing agricultural income. To assess the feasibility of taxing agricultural income, suggested against it. Therefore, the British government did not tax the agriculture. Okay, next line you can write. After independence in 1972, A committee was set up under the chairmanship of K.N. Raj, which suggested tax on rich farmers. But due to political reasons, this report was never implemented. All right. Now, come to 2002. Okay, the Kelkar Task Force report. Estimated that 95% of farmers. Are below the tax threshold. That is 2.5 lakhs. Taxing agricultural income comes under the state list. In some states, income from horticulture and plantation, is taxed because they are commercial crops. Now, Niti Aayog has given a recommendation. To tax agricultural income also. So this suggestion has been criticized. All right. So Niti Aayog has said that this agricultural income should be taxed, as a result of which there are various voices. Some are in support of it, some are against it. All right. So you can write the next line. Even without taxation, the contribution of agricultural income to GDP is decreasing since independence. Okay, so in between, from independence it is decreasing, but you must remember this data, that from 1991 to 2006, okay, between this period your contribution has declined from 32% to 15% or 14%, whatever is the value. Okay, you can round it to 15%. Like I said, right now agricultural income contribution to GDP is only 15%, and this figure is important because this, if you look at the various questions of UPSC mains last year, you may find that many a times the question is with respect to post-liberalization. So you need to remember the data point for 1991 as also. Okay, so you can see that if the contribution of agriculture in the GDP is falling, and you are going to tax agricultural income also, then the farming community will not be very much happy with that. Okay, many young people living in the rural area will not take agricultural as their livelihood. Okay, so that may create some kind of issues with your food security. Okay, so we need to make agricultural remunerative and a sustainable livelihood opportunity. Okay, and hence there are voices that agricultural income should not be taxed. Okay, so right, but this has not led to a concomitant decrease in the number of people dependent on agriculture. Concomitant, मतलब consequent decrease. But this has not led to a concomitant decrease in the number of people dependent on agriculture. All right. Agriculture still contributes 49% of total manpower. Agriculture still contributes 49% of total manpower and 64% of rural manpower. Okay, next point you can write. It will further increase. It will further increase the tax collection workload. It will further increase the tax collection workload of already stressed manpower. Of already stressed manpower of the tax administration without substantially increasing the tax collection. Without substantially increasing the tax collection. Third point you can write. In the last few years, the input costs of farmers have gone up. The input cost of farmers have gone up, but there is not a corresponding increase. But there is not a corresponding increase in their output. Thus, agriculture is no more seen as a remunerative job. Thus, agriculture is no more seen as a remunerative job. Putting additional tax on agriculture will lead to no one preferring it. Okay. Last point is the informal nature of agriculture. The informal nature of agriculture makes it difficult to tax it. Alright, so these are the various issues which will come up when you decide to tax agricultural income. Okay, you see, you have a lot many people employed in agricultural sector, but you have limited workforce in the tax department. Okay, and the amount of tax which you will collecting from each and every farmer will be very less. So you will be investing, the cost of collection of tax will be more as compared to the amount of revenue which will get generated.